If you have your Bibles, we'd ask that you turn to the book, the Gospel of Luke, Luke chapter 9, and we're going to begin reading in verse 17. Luke chapter 9, beginning in verse 17. And they did eat and were all filled, and there were taken up of fragments that remained to them 12 baskets. And it came to pass, as he was alone praying, his disciples were with him, and he asked them, saying, "Whom say the people that I am?" And they answered and said, "John the Baptist, but some say Elias, and others say one of the old prophets is risen again." He said unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" Peter answering said, "The Christ of God." And he straightly charged them and commanded them to tell no man that thing. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your watch care. Lord, we thank you for the happiness that you bring in our lives from time to time. We thank you for being the only steady part in our lives, Lord, and we give you the praise for that. Lord, we pray tonight that you would speak to sinners, Lord, that you would speak life, that you would save those that meet with us routinely that need you so desperately, Lord, that you'd manifest that their need is you, nothing more, nothing less, Lord. Those of us that are saved, give us a mind to serve you, that we would be desirous to be found in your perfect will, Lord, and not be satisfied just to remain, Lord. We pray these things in the sweet and the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Now tonight I'll be preaching on the thought, the road that you follow. Now we'll get a little further down into that in a minute, but let me just say first of all, you are going somewhere. You are following a road somewhere every day, every moment in your life. You're on the road somewhere, and if you don't be real careful, I'll say this, if no other road exists for you, you're on the road to your grave anyway. You're on your road to the end of what your life is about. Now, verse 17, and they, meaning the whole multitude, 5,000 men, besides women and children, and they all did eat and were filled. Now, I want you to see, first of all, that that's one thing that we do not trust God for. And I'm not talking about earthly food, although He does provide that. Every time we sit at a meal, we ought to give thanks because we got that by His divine grace. We think, well, I went and bought the food and I earned the money. And no, don't ever be too careful to give Him the praise for that food. And I'll tell you, the only time you'll ever recognize that's when it's gone. When you don't have anything left to eat. And so I want you to see they brought all those up, and they brought up the 12 baskets, which shows that our Lord sustains His people. But let me say this, He sustains them best when they are in His will. Now, if they are not in His will, He will give them provision, but He provides best when you're in His perfect will. And that was the teaching that the Lord gave them in addition to the miracles that He wanted everybody to see. I want you to see in verse 18, He gives a great display of prayer. You know what? He didn't sit around for the accolades and the praises. After that huge miracle was done, He went somewhere and began to pray. You know what would be a good thing tonight if God's people would get somewhere and just get out by ourselves and begin to pray and ask God to help us and meet with us as a needy people. We're having a meeting in October, and I thought about this as we've been preparing for that. How many of you be embarrassed for the women to go down on this side around that oak tree and the men go up in the oak grove up here and just lay our needs out before God and ask Him that if He might meet with us and make it a revival that we would remember? You know where that's how revival started 100 years ago. It wasn't just a little routine meeting. We had a revival for the year, but those people meant business with God. And so we see that He puts prayer as a priority. And then He asked them, "Whom say the people that I am?" And that's a wonderful question. A lot of people saying a lot of things about Jesus. It's always been that way. You look here, and their description of Jesus went from Elisha to a resurrected John the Baptist to one of the minor prophets, such as Jonah. They had all these ideas about who Jesus was, except none of them, the people, said that he was the Son of God. Now, we live in a day and age, a lot is still being said about Jesus, but nobody is saying that he is the living Son of God. And if that's not true, we are people most miserable. We might as well not even be here tonight if that is not the case. We might as well pack up and go to the house because none of it's real anyway. And so, who do you say Jesus is? Who do you describe as the sinless Son of God? Who do you say that Jesus is? Because that's really pivotal of your faith. Do you think he's completely God? I do. Do you think he's completely man? I do. He came in the likeness of sinful flesh. Now, I also say this, he's all in one, the Godhead. But who do you say that he is? You know what? I believe if we ever get our mind on Christ and see who... You know, really, salvation is this, is seeing Christ for who he is. It really is. And I'm not talking about up here, but I'm talking down here. And so that's what he says. Then he says, and he said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? Peter answered and said, the Christ of God. Now, Matthew's rendering of that says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. They mean the exact same thing. Peter understood who Jesus was. And I ask you this evening, do you really understand who Jesus is? Because I think, Lord, and you go around and see other so-called churches, and what they all lack is a reverence to God. They don't know who Jesus is. You can say, you know what? We're not here to go roller skating tonight. We're here to talk about the sinless Son of God. We're not here to have a big party. And we're not here, you know what? Vacation Bible school's good. But you know what? We're not there to have a party. We're not there to entertain. We're there to hear about the sinless Son of God. Man. And people do not like that anymore.
Right.
You know what part of us likes entertainment? Our flesh. That's what it's really about. So we really need to decide then, are we even here for the right reasons? Are we present tonight to hear of the true Son of God, or are we just wasting time? Verse 21, and he straightly charged them and commanded them that tell no man that thing. Now, I think that's very unusual because other times he does not say that. But the reason he says, you don't tell anybody yet, because he had things to do. He had an agenda when he arrived here on the earth. He knew exactly what to do, when to do it, and he kept every faithful thing to that. So it wasn't quite time for him to be revealed. And so he says, you keep it to yourself for a while. You keep that near you for a time, and I'll give you an opportunity to tell later. Now go down a little further, and he says, the Son of Man must suffer many things, and be rejected of the elders, and chief priests, and scribes, and be slain, and be raised the third day. So he gives them the entire plan. Not only does he predict the ones that would go after him, he said then, I'm going to be raised on the third day. He gave them the full plan even then. And people now want to deny his sovereignty. You know what? God does what he wants to do. It's always been that way, and he certainly doesn't need our permission. He accomplishes what he will, and he'll do it. And so we see then that the Lord said, don't tell anybody yet, but I will be raised again. Verse 23. And he said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. The road that you follow. Now, It seems like a simplistic thing, and most preachers today will tell you that's an easy thing to do. Let me tell you, that's the hardest thing you will ever do, is truly follow Jesus. It is the most difficult thing. And you know why? The reason why that's so difficult is the majority of us don't even know what that is. We've never really done it. We've never really come down to the point, hey, this is going to come first in my life, and if everything else is set aside, I'm going to follow Jesus. Now, the Lord inspired, He told it very well. The first thing is self-denial. And that's the hardest thing you will ever do. Of the plan to follow Jesus, the first step in denying self is the first. It's the hardest part. Now, I studied a lot, and I'm just using this as an example, so don't stone me. But, you know, there are a lot of overweight people in our world today. I think part of it's genetic. I truly agree with that. But I think this, all of us do not like to deny self. If we have a choice between a piece of squash and a cupcake, which one are you going to take? And you know why? Because we won't deny ourselves. And I'm not criticizing, I'm going for the cupcake. But it's because we will not deny ourselves. And we will never follow the Lord Jesus as long as we're in that situation. We've got to learn to deny ourselves. So he gives us the outline of our life. If any man will come after me, first of all, you have to decide, do you really want to follow Jesus? Now, at that point in their lives, think about what they had seen Jesus do. Now, he revealed the plan, but he revealed that plan more than once, and they just didn't get it. But what he had just said is, I'm going to die. You come and follow me. You know, that wasn't a woo-hoo time, but they just didn't get it. And don't get down on the apostles. Most of the time, we don't get it either. We really don't. And so we see that the first thing, if we're going to follow him, is make a decision, do we really want that or do we not? If any man come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily. Now, you're getting a good meeting. Lord's meeting with his people. You're rejoicing and glad in the things of the Lord. And the Lord, and the next day at work, that person that you can't hardly stand anyway starts pushing your buttons. And you've all forgot about how good God's been to you by 10 o'clock the next day. Right? You know why? We've got to pick it up daily. And you know what? A cross, when you carry a cross, you can carry nothing but that cross because of the way it's shaped. The crosses that we see, the crucifix, which is a Catholic fable, but the crosses we see today does not do the cross justice that our Lord Jesus died upon, because it was so tall that when they stood it up, that's what hung them above everybody else, is the center pole was so tall. Now that had to be dragged behind them as he went up Golgotha's hill. He was dragging that thing, and it was to be inserted into the ground, and it would stand up above everybody else. That's a very difficult thing to carry, and you have to have a plan. You know, most people don't even have a plan for their Christian life. Well, I'm saved now. Let's go. Well, that's good. I rejoice in your salvation. But do you have a plan to follow Jesus? Do you have a plan to get that cross that you're going to pick up to the end time? Your cross is yours from the day you're saved to the day you die, or we got called up hither. And don't say, well, Brother Larry, I'm not a preacher, so I don't have a cross. The only reason you don't is you never picked it up to start with. That's it. It's not that you weren't assigned one. It's that you didn't pick it up. And so as we go along the way, don't excuse yourself. You know what? Really, the gospel, the good news of the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, In that sense, it should be a burden to us. It should be something every day that we want to carry with us and take with us and share with people that we meet along the way. The gospel should be a burden. It should be something that you pick up. And you can see my Bible. I hadn't left this one on the top of the car and lost it like I have a lot of mine along the way. I've had this Bible 4 years. Donna lets me buy one every 10. And so this one's got a little ways to go. But I take it with me. If I forget it, something's wrong. One day I left it sitting by the phone and Donna called me and says, "Do you feel all right?" And I said, "I feel fine." She goes, "Oh, well, you left your Bible." And she thought I was sick. That's a burden you should pick up every day. That's a burden you should pick up every day. Take it with you. Because you never know when you're going to have the opportunity to say, "Let me tell you about the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me tell you about the goodness of God's grace." Not works, not Holy Ghost receiving, whatever that means. But let me just tell you about what Christ did for me and what He can do for you. Pick up the burden. And so if we're to do that as the Lord's people, and certainly we should, then we have to pick up the cross. We have to do it daily. And then He says, "And follow me." Now, think about when He says that. How many followed through? It's real easy, church. Zero. Some went a long ways. Remember John chapter 6? It said, after that, many left Him. And He looks at the apostles and says, "Will you go also?" And Peter says, "To whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life." But you know what? The 11 that were left, they did leave. And so don't get down on the apostles, because in the light of death, you probably would be leaving too. And the threatenings that it was truly going to come your way, you probably would leave too. They scattered. They were gone. And we find John the Apostle follows at a distance, and Peter at a greater distance still, watching what was coming on, but never doing. So when you decide to follow, understand what it means. People are not there to be glad for you. Verse 24, He makes it even more clear. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. The Gospel of Matthew says the same thing like this: the same shall find it. Now, that says to me a lot of us have never really found our life to start with. That makes sense? I knew in 1986, after doing that little CNA program down in Erin, I knew I wanted to be a registered nurse. I didn't know how I was going to accomplish it, and that's been 30 years ago, but I knew that's what I wanted to do. That was what I was going to do professionally, some way, somehow. And the Lord helped me with that. And I got my nurse's license. I began my career. But you know what? That should not have been my focus. See, we lose our life a lot of time in what we're doing. And you wake up and one day you're 50, 60, and 70 years old. And you've really done nothing for the cause of. So if you want to save your life, lose it. Give everything to Christ. You know what? As the rich young ruler came to the Lord Jesus Christ, what did He say to him? He says, "You sell it all and come and follow me." The thing is today, and I'm not telling y'all to go and sell your things at home. If you want to, God's leading you that way, that's fine. But sell out for Christ. In other words, if He says, "Listen, I don't care how old you are, I want you to spread the gospel," you go and do it. You get the job done. How old was Moses when he was called? 80. Right? How much of the time do you feel like you're spinning your wheels? I feel that way a lot of times. That I'm like, Lord, is there something else I need to be doing? And certainly I have to provide for my wife and my daughters and be sure they have their needs. But sometimes I just kind of feel like I'm spinning my wheels. What am I doing? And when I stand before Christ, what will He say? You know what? Just because you're redeemed does not mean you'll hear those blessed words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." That is not for everybody. Don't ever convince yourself that it is, because it is not. You say, that's pretty dismal. No, I'm just telling you the truth as your pastor, because the Bible says some would be saved so as by fire. And you know what? We constantly do that. Well, that's those people that were saved at the last moment before they died. Well, where do you get that? It never clarifies it that way in the Bible, does it? I don't see that text say anything about when you're going to die. It's people that did nothing. That's who it is. It's people that did nothing. And so we see then that we as the Lord's people then, we must be focused on what we are given to do. I want to look very quickly, and I'll get through this as quickly as I can, at a couple of Bible characters that ran the race, that finished up, that knew what this teaching was about. And neither one of them, well, two of them saw the Lord Jesus, and one of them didn't. Go me to the book of Acts, chapter 9, verse 6, the conversion of Paul. You all know it. Acts 9 and verse 6, and he, meaning Paul, trembling and astonished, said, "Lord, what wilt thou have me to do?" And the Lord said unto him, "Arise, go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do." Now, does that little word, M-U-S-T, give you any options? What you must do. Now the problem is today, we've heard that, you know, in addition to making a mockery of salvation, Arminian teaching does this as well. It's your choice. If you want to serve Him, serve Him. And if you don't, that's okay too. But Paul was told, this is what you must do. This is what you have to do. There's no options. Now, when the Lord saves our soul, and even at the time when the Lord Jesus was called back up to glory, He says, "Go ye into all the world and teach them whatsoever I have taught you, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost." And that wasn't an option. Right? Did He say, "If you want to"? No. It was a must do. It was just like He was given here. It's not an option. We are to go. And you know the conversion of Paul, he did exactly as he was bidden to do. Go with me in Acts chapter 16. Acts 16, verse 23. Acts 16 and verse 23, the Bible says, "And when they had laid many stripes upon them," meaning Paul and Silas. Now remember, the Lord Jesus said what you must do. And then we hear from probably as much as 7 years later, "And when they had laid many stripes upon them." You know what? I just know my flesh probably better than you know it. That'd been quitting time for me. I didn't get as many whippings as I needed as a child, but I got some. I got a scar right here on the back of my leg, right here. And how I got his mama whipped me good. And you know what? I deserved it. I was in the backwater playing Little House on the Prairie. And the problem is, it's going to sweep me away and drown me. She dragged me out of the creek and whipped me all the way back to the house. Now, that wasn't optional. Us, you know, I was ready to quit praying Little House on the Prairie. I was ready to go to the house. Here they have many, many stripes on them, and you do not find them quitting. You find them going on. In fact, at midnight, they're praying and singing unto the praises of God, and everybody, you know what? I would love to know the content of that prayer, but I'm guessing we never will. But I do know this. I don't think it was, "Lord, please deliver us. Lord, please get us out of this mess. Lord, please help us." I believe they're going, "Blessed be the name of the Lord high, and lofty and mighty are His ways. Glorious is His name. Mighty things does He do." It wasn't a woo-hoo. That's what we've equated prayer today to. "Give me, give me, give me. My name's Jimmy." If that's all the prayer you've got, you don't have much of a prayer life. And so we see then Paul was in a situation and he was still following. The roads where He take you will not always be pleasant. Verse 25, I just quoted it. "At midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them." Now, one more place concerning this servant, 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, chapter number 4, verse 11. 2 Timothy 4 and verse 11. I'm sorry, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. The Bible says, "For I'm now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith." Now, a couple of things on that I want you to see. First of all, this was nearing the end, and he was still following. He was still going on. He was still with his mindset. And you know what? I believe even then, if God had given him something else to do, to the best of his ability, Paul would have tried to follow through. He was still following. And the problem is this: today, we don't see it for what it is. You know, we think trials and tribulations, and listen, I understand with the situation we're in and the Sodomites taking over and the Muslims taking over our country that American men have bled and died for. Listen, hard times are coming, but right now we have been so blessed and so laden in luxury, we don't want to get up and do nothing. I was thinking this week, and I ain't gonna drag y'all down there yet because I don't have a tent. But in addition to the street preaching, I'd love to see an old tent, a tent meeting again, wouldn't you? Just wherever the Lord took me, go and set up in this place and see what God would do. If He leads me, I'm going. And you say, "Oh, people would come. It's the dog days of summer and it's hot and blah, blah." Well, you know, if God's leading you, if one person comes, that's what was meant to happen, right? The problem is we want a Billy Graham crusade, right? You know, two or three are getting to get together. And so that means if Brother Ashley and I go, and one more person shows up, we have enough to meet, right? And that should be our desire, and that should be our mindset, is just to go. And we don't see that anymore because we measure our results in the wrong way. So is it a thing that God would have for us just to sit and to be idle and stay where we're at? I really don't think so. I think we should be a mobile people and do something for God. And so we see that his life is soon over. Go with me to Acts chapter 8 again. Acts 8. We read of another individual. Acts 8, verse 5. The Bible says, "Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them." Now, Philip was one of the deacons, one of them that was set over the affairs of buying and dispensing food. And here we find him preaching. He is given a job to do. He does not grumble. He does not complain. He simply goes and preaches Christ. He does exactly what he's bidden to do, down to Samaria, preaching Christ. Verse 8, and there was great joy in that city. Now, could you imagine if he had not gone, if he had not been obedient and followed through, there would be none of that joy that was experienced. Drop down to verse 12. Now, when they believed Philip, preaching the three things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. And so we know that there was a church that was developed out of that. He was obedient. He went. He followed the master. He did exactly what he was told to do. And you say, yeah, Philip was a preacher. Well, he was a preacher and he was a deacon, but it never says that he was a pastor. He was a man that followed God. Drop down to verse 8. Verse 29. Acts 8, verse 29. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. Now, I want you to see the meeting is past. He's just on the road. And the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the capital S Spirit, in that statement says, go join thyself to that chariot. Now, that's a very small duty compared to preaching a revival down in Samaria. But I want you to see that it was a command of God, and Philip did it. Now, we know a church came out of Samaria. The best we know, this meeting with the eunuch, one individual was saved. Just the obedience of Philip. Just doing exactly what he was told to do. Just following through with it. That's where we need to be. That's where we need to gear ourselves and desire to just be obedient to what he is, what he does. If we're going to pick up our cross and we're going to follow him, just keep doing it. Now go with me one more last place in Acts chapter 15, just a little further over. Acts 15, we'll read in verse 36. Acts 15 and verse 36, the Bible says, and some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they do. Are the churches progressing? Are they standing for the faith? And Barnabas determined to take with them John, whose surname was Mark, John Mark. But Paul thought not good to take them, who departed from Pamphylia and went with them to the work. Now we will find that Paul had an issue with John Mark, and this was it, is that John Mark went home. He did not finish this missionary journey. He left at Pamphylia and went back home to Lois and Eunice and did not finish the trip. That's what happened. And you know, that's most of us today, is we're not finishing the trip. We're not following through. We're not standing faithful. Now, if you know your Bible, you know things improved. As Paul was near his death in 2 Timothy, he says, you send Mark to me, for now he's profitable. So that means to me and you, it may be that we have not followed the Lord very closely. We put things of this world first. Idols that we've set up in our own mind, our career, our money, our homes, our houses, whatever it could be. It could be simply, it could be something as simple as a pair of trousers that you worship. But you can be like John Mark and make that thing. It comes down to this. Do you want to pick up your cross or not? Something you have to pick up every morning and be the last thing that you put down. My wife and my daughter will attest to this. The first thing I do every morning is I reach my left hand over to my bedside table, and I do that before I even get out of bed. And the very last thing I do, I read my book, whatever book I'm reading at the time at the bedside, and I put them on top of that book. And that needs to be your cross. The very first thing you pick up, the very last thing you put to bed. You know what's a wonderful way to put your cross down? It just, at the end of the day, just pour all your needs out before the Lord. Go through your children and your grandchildren's names. Pray that the Lord might save them. Got two grandbabies now. Lord, be every day that I say, Lord God, bless Gracie. Save her soul someday. God, touch Abigail. Keep her safe. Every day. And then when I'm done, I can lay the cross down for that night, go off to sleep, and the very first thing I do is pick it back up in the morning and head out again. That's where we need to be.